Okay, so I'm not going to try anything too ambitious here. It's mostly just testing out the technology, seeing if I can get all of this to work together. If you've been following on my blog, you'll see that I've been working on a lot of Ansible stuff, and part of that is improving the monitoring of servers that are either personal servers or servers that I run for HamBSD or other groups. And something that's missing from that is monitoring of the APRS stations, specifically whether or not they're putting data into APRSIS. So hopefully at the end of this stream I'm going to have a Nagios plugin that allows me to check through the aprs.fi API whether or not a APRS station has been recently updating its position, and a couple of other checks that I was thinking of doing, looking at the last time that another station was heard, so whether or not it's receiving transmissions, and also perhaps looking at how far away those transmissions are. If there's another station that you can reliably hear, maybe you would want to know when's the last time you heard that station. And while I'm making this to work with the aprs.fi API, my hope is that the APRS software that I'm developing for HamBSD is going to have the same API available. So you could, instead of querying aprs.fi, make the query against your iGate or DigiPeter, and then it would be able to tell you whether or not it had heard these stations on the radio interface, that sort of thing. So this is mostly a check of, does the technology work, am I able to produce a stream, but that's the goal that I've set for this, and we'll see how far I get. I'm watching the Twitch chat on another screen, so if you have some questions or comments or anything, I'm watching there, but it's on the iPad, so I might struggle to respond. It might take me a few minutes. Okay. Right there. So you should now be able to see the machine that I'm going to be working with, and at the moment, completely blank machine. And I'm just going to install an OpenBSD snapshot. So the setup I've got here is I'm using QEMU, and then I've got a second X server running. I'm running QEMU full screen on that second X server, and then doing a full screen capture for that second screen, and then importing that into OBS. So it seems to be okay for the console view. I've not tried running Xorg in OpenBSD yet in this setup. So let's find out. Just using the default QEMU matted interface, so it should give me a DHCP lease okay. interesting choice for the so now that's not this has not gone very well. That's a very small disk. Okay, I think I was trying to be a bit too clever. I was trying to write the installer image over the front of the hard disk image and boot it that way. I guess that's not working. I'll boot it from CD-ROM instead. And then I might need to remove the CD-ROM after I reboot it, or it's going to boot from the CD-ROM again. That's looking more like it. I notice we've gone to 6.7 for the snapshots now. I don't know where we are in the release cycle, but I guess that means we're getting closer. Changed my mind. So the sets should be on the disk, so it'll go a lot quicker. Oh wow, still wants a little while for that. At least it doesn't have to wait for it to download now. So I can just say a bit about what the plans are with the aprs software. So I started off with trying to write everything in C with privilege separation where anything's passed from the network. aprs.d, the digipeater and beacon, is complicated. It's got a lot of moving parts. And trying to start off with a privilege separated system before I know what the whole thing does isn't really going very well. So I need to design it a bit better, and the way that I find it's easiest to design the thing is to make one first that I'm going to throw away. So the idea is to do this in Python. I'm still going to use the axtap and axkiss kernel devices that are in HamBSD, and on the other side of the axtap interface is still going to be the C version of aprs.isd for connection to aprs.is. But the idea is to get the digipeating, iGating, encapsulation of third-party packets, deduplication, rate limiting, all of that done in Python. And then I can start saying, okay, these functionalities can go together, these go together. And it might even be that aprs.d doesn't do all of these things in the end. Maybe PyAprs.d carries on as a thing afterwards for people that need more complicated setups. And one thing that aprs.d is not going to have is database storage for packets that have been heard to allow you to do something like aprs.fi on your own, which is what a future Nagios plugin would talk to. Okay, so that's the sets installed. Perhaps an SSD would be a good thing to have. I was hoping to be able to do the streaming from the HamBSD laptop. So I have a laptop just for HamBSD development, but the adapter that I was going to use it's got VGA output, and I was going to use USB VGA capture box, and I got it on eBay, but unfortunately the seller seems to have been affected by the coronavirus and hasn't been able to post it yet, so I don't have that yet. Okay, so this might be taking a while because I think QEMU is only running with one core because I didn't tell it to have more than one. Oh, I wonder if I'm even. Okay, yeah, I'm not even using the KVM acceleration. So on the host operating system, it's running Debian, and Debian seems to have had some changes with the QEMU system packages that have split out the GUI part into another package. So I was fighting with that for a while to be able to get a GUI working. I had to ended up filing a bug actually. What is it? Debian bug 956377, because the GUI package doesn't automatically upgrade your QEMU package to the correct version. Okay, so that's finished out. I'll halt it and then I'll restart QEMU with the KVM. The CD-ROM. Okay. Oh dear. That's suboptimal. I'm not sure how to deal with that. Maybe just the zoom was wrong. Okay. That's not bad. Okay, so the first thing that we need to do is install some stuff. Python. I don't know, is the quality on this okay that you can read the text? I think OpenBSD's gone for 1080. But the virtual X server I've got is only 768, and then I'm scaling that down, and then that's getting mapped to a 1080 canvas again in OBS, which is then getting scaled down again to 768 for streaming, so I hope it's not too messed up. This bit can't be particularly thrilling content. Okay, so the next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to try running my Ansible playbooks I've been working on, and the goal is to set up this machine with some consistent configuration to other machines that I use, and once that's done, configure Nagios to run on this machine. Yeah, the size on my end is super tiny, but if the quality is okay, then that's okay. Oh wow, there's a lot of Firefox. See if I can start off with did it install Git already, or is Git coming later on? Well, let me scroll up to see. One thing I'm going to have to watch out for is my Ansible playbooks have all been designed so far for running on servers, which I only access by SSH, and they don't have passwords. But I need to actually log into this machine at a console, so I have to make sure that if I run the playbook, it's not going to wipe out the password for the user that I'm trying to log in as. But once the playbooks run, it will create a user account for me, set up DOAS so that I can become root, sets the time zone, does a few other things, installs Nagios remote plugin execution for remote monitoring, sets the SSH key for backup PC so that I can include it in my backups, and it also saves the SSH host keys and the Ike public keys. At some point I'd like to take the Ike keys and automatically set up IPsec transport mode between all of the servers that are in the same playbook. So the HamBSD APRS stations, MB7 VX and MB7 UAR. Both of those talk IPsec to the main gateway in London, and that's how they get their 44 net IP addresses. Okay, so Git has appeared. I can check out Okay, so I have an inventory here, which is the inventory that I'm using to manage all of my infrastructure, but just for this I'm going to make a new inventory, and I'll say servers localhost. And once Ansible is installed, we can have a look at that. It's off Firefox ESR. It might be that one core is not enough for Firefox. I just wanted to take a look at what the server common role does. So I've split the server common role up into a whole bunch of stuff. It supports OpenBSD, and to a lesser extent it supports Debian Linux as well. And the backup PC step just installs the SSH key to allow backup PC. Sudo won't happen in OpenBSD. Duaz says anyone that's in the group for being an operator gets added to wheel, and then anyone that is in wheel can do passwordless Duaz. Sets up user accounts for non-priv users. Sets up remote plugin execution for Nagios, disables password authentication and root login for SSH. The IPsec setup at the moment only fetches the IKE keys and don't do anything with them yet. And then the services setup, that disables Sound.io. So I guess probably I need a workstation setup that's separate from the server setup to take care of not removing the user passwords, and you still want Sound.io on workstations where you don't want it on servers. Okay, but we're not going to use Sound.io here, so the only thing that I'm really concerned about is not deleting the password, and leave the root password in as well. Okay, and that should be using the QEMU inventory and the server command. And let's see how this goes. Okay, so for the DNS servers, I use tsig signatures on zone transfers, and the secret is stored in the Ansible vault. But in this case, we don't care about that. So I'll comment that out. So it's still SSHing into localhost. I think that might present a problem because we disabled root login. And it can't log in because there's no SSH key. So we'll make one of those. And again. It's kind of hard to tell if this is just taking a while or if it's waiting for a timeout. Yeah, if things start to take too long, I'll shut it down, give it more memory and more CPUs. Well, some Python stuff is running. Just about. Okay, right. Forget this. System. Okay, so I've given it 8 cores and 10 gigs of RAM. Okay. I don't know how to disable. So the problem is that usually I use Ansible's become. Where is the? Aha, become yes. So if I make that comment for the first run, and not become no, because that's. Typing. Aha. Right, yeah, and then everything depends on there being a Nagios host. So the every server is set up to be monitored by Nagios, but it doesn't know about any of the Nagios hosts, because I didn't find any. And we're going to run Nagios on localhost, so. I wonder if that will work. I think that won't work. I need to tell it what its IP address is as well. And I keep typing vim instead of vi. Now it knows what IP address to put into the config file. Ooh, and I've locked myself out as root. Root, do not SSH, /pub. And that should be. I'm just going to say that the key that we've made here is the backup PC key, because backup PC can log in as root to do the backups. And then that will stop that from. It's created me a user account, so I'll set the I'm don't like this. I don't like that it won't let me type bad passwords. I wonder if you can tell it to ignore that. Must be set in password check in login.com. Anyway, okay, that worked. I wonder how badly it will break if I just try and run this Nagios playbook now. So the actual installation of Nagios is pretty simple, both on OpenBSD and on Debian. But once you've installed it, if you install it from packages on OpenBSD, from Debian Archive on Debian, you get very different things. It seems that the distribution packages have put in example configurations that are specific to the distribution it's running on, instead of having some general configuration examples. So in this playbook I want it to work on both OpenBSD and on Debian, so I'm going to have to basically throw away all of the example config and unpick that that comes with the packages and replace it. I tried to deploy the config that I have on Debian. It installs fine, but there are a number of missing commands or duplicate commands, and so I'm just going to replace the whole of the config. Which does mean I get to organize it the way that works best, instead of trying to work around the way that the example config was written. You just have to think about it more. Admin email is undefined. Okay. I guess there's going to be a problem here that I've configured things to work with HTTPS. But this is not externally accessible, so it's going to try doing Acme client and it's going to fail every time. There's going to be no certificate to actually get to this with. Okay, so I've got specific templates for different servers, but this is just a minimal setup, so none of these things exist. So I'm gonna write down actually that's a thing that I should fix. Only generate Nagios configs for existing groups. I want this to be kind of modular because I'm using it for a number of different things. Each domain has its own things that it needs to have, so for now I'm going to do the easy thing and I'm just going to delete them from the thing. Actually, I can just say start at task. Install servers configuration, and just skip over the bits at the start there. Okay, and that says that's going. So, okay, it's not going great. And the reason for that is that I check that the HTTP server on Nagios is working, and I've got those command definitions in the www template that we just removed, I think. Let's check. So Nagios-B www.etc.nagios. Yeah, check commands. Roles, Nagios, tasks, main, templates, Nagios. Easy thing to do here is just going to be delete those. And I'll just run those again. There we go. Okay, right. Nagios is running, and these tests are run by the remote execution thing. Okay, so the next thing to do is going to be to have a look at building the plugin that's going to test out if station has been heard recently. I'm going to use the aprs.fi API for this. Okay, so there's a So it allows you to check weather and location, but I don't know if it actually allows you to check when something was heard. I mean, when a station last heard another station. Okay, well, anyway, let's have a look. Okay, Python 3 is working. Okay, so the first thing is going to be to get a JSON response from the API. I don't want to depend on the requests library here, because even though it's a pretty neat library, I want to keep the dependencies minimal. these are the return codes for Nagios plugin. The plugins they work with iSinger and a bunch of other stuff as well, so it's a standard format for how these work. Yeah, this is so small I can't easily tell if I've got single quotes or double quotes. I'm gonna have to fix this screen for next time. API key is. Okay, so you can see here, these are the that's the digipeater downhill, that's the iGate. What's that one? Oh, cool. Okay, so my account is going to be here somewhere. It's linked from here. Here we go. Name equals. And I won't specify the full somewhere. Okay, right. Test is I. You know how checkouts and like cash things have the double zero? You need a key on the keyboard that's just four spaces. Okay, there it is. So I think the thing here is the last time. That's the one that we care about. Does that look like a Unix timestamp, or how do you get Python datetime from Unix timestamp? Seems like a good Stack Overflow question. UTC from timestamp. That's a sensible function. There's a lot of error handling missing here, but let's see if this is. No attribute UTC. Ah, of course, that was too easy. Date time from timestamp, not UTC from timestamp. There we go, okay. 2020, 04, 10, 14, 58. That seems reasonable. Okay, so if it's not in entries, that means that if it's not in entries, then it's not in the database. So if main response entries. Idiomatic Python. 1, 2, 3, 4. Return critical. Call sign not known to aprs.fi. I will say last seen I don't know if that's implicit. Let me just say that. Okay, and that's that there. Now let's see if we can give it. Okay. Right, now let's see if we can plug this into Nagios. aprs station used in host definition could not be found. Oh, but it's there. How do you do these? How do these work? Okay, so the problem is that it is not called hostname, it is called name. And I think I should use a generic host here. Contacts, that's okay. Okay. Okay, right, so they don't show up with services because I've just done them as host checks. There we go, up last seen on that date. And this one, I imagine this check will run very soon. No, it thinks it's going to run in 2 minutes. Okay, let's just get that one to run now. There we go. Okay, and just to be sure it's working, use aprs station hostname MMOR-13, which should not have been seen. There we go, call sign not known to aprs.fi. Okay, I think I'm going to leave this stream here. I'm going to integrate this back into the Ansible playbook that I've been working on, and I'll tidy this up a bit as well. But that's, I'm quite happy with that. That was a lot easier than I thought it would be. So thanks for watching. I see there are a few viewers, so I hope this was worthwhile. I've got some ideas on what I need to improve next time, getting the screen resolution sorted out, and making sure that I've allocated enough resources to the virtual machine to do the experiment, although who knows, maybe the VGA grabber will arrive. Thanks for watching. I'll stick the Patreon in the chat, if you want to stay updated with things. Where's the chat? I've lost the chat. I'm going to have to type this in on the iPad. So it's patreon.com/ Foxtrot Oscar Sierra India Romeo Lima. I've spelt Patreon wrong in the chat, but that's meant to be Patreon. Okay, thanks very much, and I'll hope to do some more streaming soon.